Thanks very much for coming to this workshop. I myself wanted to go to the pure script React, but what are you going to do? Where shall I begin? Where I should begin is, in fact, just telling you that this entire talk is online, and I'm doing this rather weird thing where you can actually edit the slides as we go along. Okay, so not all of you, you will not be editing my slides. If you point your browser to that, URL at the top, then, you know, you can see all these slides, and as we go along, there'll be little code, windows that appear, and we'll be filling in code as we go along. Okay, so I strongly encourage you to go and go to that particular URL and follow along as I do the talk, right? And also, unlike Richard's lovely workshop, which I ought to have learned a lot from, but I was too busy fiddling with my CSS to get everything right, there's going to be questions as we go along, right? So I'm just going to be throwing out exercises as we go. So TLDR, just go to that URL and scroll down with me as we go along. Okay, so what exactly is refinement types? Or what is the purpose of refinement types? At a high level, what we want to do is the kind of thing that you'd want to do with something like address, but we want to make it a lot more automatic and a lot less. Yes?
We lost the URL.
It's not working? No. Oh, you lost the URL. Sorry, my bad. I wonder if I should even just, I should just keep that thing up there. Okay. ucsd-proxys.github.io. It's also on the LambdaConf. Yes? There isn't a branch, but we're having some trouble upgrading. So unfortunately, the short answer is no. You go to the GitHub and you switch your branches, and it's a bit convoluted. So I wouldn't recommend it just yet. There's something we're trying to actively do. I couldn't get it done in time for this for today. Okay, can I switch the URL?
Yes,
okay, no worries. Okay, good. I'm just going to do this locally because it'll be a little faster and I don't want to have to deal with any concurrency issues arising due to you guys. Okay, fantastic. So here's the general plan, right? So as we all know, well-typed programs can go very, very wrong. Here are some of the favorite examples. So here's the dinkiest example that we've all had. And really, I'm not so excited about division, except that it's just an easy way to motivate to get the ball rolling, right? So if I write a little average function, I try and divide by the length of the list. It's all very well if the list is not empty, but God help me if the list is empty, I get this nasty runtime error. Most of you probably haven't seen this kind of thing, but I bet you have seen this kind of thing, right? This is the one thing that I get really irritated by, the one source of sort of null dereference errors in nice languages like Haskell and OCaml. You create a little map, and then you look up the map with various keys. For example, here I create a map with Haskell and JavaScript, and then if I look up the map with the key Haskell, I win. But again, if I look up the map with some key that's not in it, then it blows up, right? So here's yet another, it's a very small example of something where it's easy to make mistakes and get things going wrong. Here's another example where it gets more and more of the same kind, but where the consequences are more drastic. So for example, you can actually try this. If you fire up GHCI, you can load up data vector, and then you can create a little vector with two elements, Haskell and JavaScript, and you can index it at the position 0, right, and it would work out fine. You can even index it at the position 1, it would work out fine. But if you index it at the position 3, then you get a nasty SEGFAULT. Okay, so it's on a high-level language and what have you, but in fact, you get a SEGFAULT. And of course, as you know, I gave this talk elsewhere, and in these kinds of situations, you're actually lucky when you get a SEGFAULT, because then your machine sort of, you know, it stops running, the program crashes, and life is good. The more pernicious situation is when you don't get the SEGFAULT, and the thing just keeps happily running and will sort of just violate all your nice type safety guarantees and can possibly leak various bits of information. So for example, again, this is something you could try at home, you could try on your machines. Load up data text unsafe, create a little string, and then you can, you know, suck out prefixes from that string. So for example, if I pull out the first 5 characters, I get lambda. Wait, that's not right. I should only get lambda. There you go. But if I try and pull out 20 characters, then I die, right? Because, well, actually, I don't die. What happens is it works just fine because at its lowest levels, data text is built on top of C, right? It's manipulating a bunch of pointers. And what's going to happen is it just happily goes and reads the next, whatever, 7 bytes that end after that buffer where LambdaConf was placed in memory, right? And this is how you could very well get your sort of heartbleed type errors in your high-level languages. So really, one of the things we want to do with dependent types and, you know, for example, the talk we saw this morning, is precisely to prevent these kinds of errors. So as Richard put it, the more information you pack into your type system, the greater confidence you have about things not going wrong. But what's really, what we'd like to do is to not have to constantly coach the type checker about very simple facts about arithmetic and about comparisons and about, you know, just, for example, if x equals y and y equals z, that x equals z. Okay, we would like to automate all these boring bits as much as possible. And that's really what our goal is. So here, what we want to do is to develop a dependent type system that will let you catch all these kinds of things at compile time, but without having to sort of break everything down into tiny steps to the type checker. So for those of you who were at the Idris talk, the reason you have to spell all these things out to Idris is that primarily the underlying decision procedure is unification. This is the way I think about it. And unification is fantastic for many things. So for example, the kinds of things Richard demonstrated with JADTs, unification is really, really good for. But there's a lot of other theories for which unification is really not the best idea. Okay? And we're going to use a somewhat different technology to make all of our machinery work. And this is, it has its sort of pros and cons, and I want to sort of walk you through what you can do with it. Okay, so here's the plan of the talk. I just gave you some sort of very high-level motivation. I have no idea how much of this we're going to get through, but, you know, we shall see as this goes, right? So what I'm first going to do is I'll just give you a very high-level overview of what exactly are refinement types anyway. Okay, how does one write a refinement? What does it even mean? And then I'll, you know, show you how, you know, I'll first just describe very simple refinement types, so things like integers, and then we look at more interesting data structures like lists and maps and so on and so forth. So having given you these very basics, then what I'm going to do is I'll illustrate how one works with LiquidHaskell with 3 sort of increasingly more sophisticated examples. Okay? Okay, so let's jump right in. I imagine there's no questions just yet, but there will be no doubt in just a second. Okay, so I click, 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 and here we go. So simple refinement types. Quite simply, for those of you who just joined, by the way, you should go to this particular URL, which is in the LambdaConf, what is it called, GitHub repo that John sent a link out to, and you should just follow along because we'll be doing the exercises as we do the talk. Okay, so what is a refinement type? Quite simply, what we're going to do is we'll take just plain old types, plain old Haskell types, and we'll dress them up with logical predicates, okay? And the idea is that these predicates are going to be drawn, they're not arbitrary predicates, they're not arbitrary user-defined functions, they're going to be drawn from well-behaved logics. And when I say well-behaved logics, what I mean is these are logics that have been studied for really nearly 100 years now, for which we have completely automatic decision procedures that work very, very fast. And every so often, I'm going to say this word SMT solver, and you should, in your head, you should just think of SMT solver as a black box that can answer questions in these specific logics. Okay? So there's no black magic. All the decision procedures, all the questions we're going to ask the SMT solvers are things that are completely decidable. There's nothing undecidable going on. But we're just going to constrain the logic so that you can prove properties about your programs while remaining automatic. Okay, so for those of you who like this sort of thing, let me just give you a high-level description of what I meant. Okay, here's a little grammar. So we start with just base types. So for now, just imagine integer, boolean, string, what have you. And then, well, not string, actually. A, B, C are just type variables, right? So I'm just going to write B for basic types. And this is the thing you want to keep your eye on. A refinement type is going to essentially look like this. We either have a basic type, which is refined with a predicate P, and I'll tell you what a predicate is in just a second. Or it's going to be a function type where we say that you take as input some variable x, which is of type t, and you produce as output some other type t. Okay? And these predicates are from decidable logics. And just for the sake of completeness, really the purpose of this talk is to give you a whole bunch of examples. But for the sake of completeness, let me just describe what I mean by predicates. Okay? So predicates are going to be things like either an expression equals an expression, or an expression is less than an expression, or and, or not, et cetera, of predicates. What do I mean by expressions? Well, here's what I mean by expressions, okay? So variables, so these are going to be literally program variables, x, y, z, numeric constants, 0, 1, 2, 3. You can add expressions, multiply them. And this last one is something to keep an eye on because this is where we're going to actually pack a whole lot of power into the type system. It's what is called an uninterpreted function. And don't worry about it. We'll look at lots of examples as we go along, right? And the high-level bit is that the logic that we're in is decidable in the sense that if P is a predicate in my logic and Q is another predicate in my logic, then there are very efficient algorithms that will decide whether P implies Q. That's the high-level bit. Okay, these have been known for a long time. Okay, good. So let's jump in and look at a very simple example, right? So this is the simplest possible refinement type that I could think of. It's a type that I'm calling zero. The reason I'm calling it zero is it describes integers, the subset of integers that are equal to zero. Okay, so what's going on over here is, let's look at the notation. It says v colon int, so it's value v, which is of type int, such that some predicate holds, and the predicate here is just value equal to zero, right? So there's exactly one value that is equal to zero, and that's the number zero, right? And so what's going to happen if I push play over here, which you can, those of you who are following along, if you push play, this is going to grind along, and it's going to say, yes, that's right. Zero is, in fact, of type zero. And now if I was to tweak this, for example, if I was to replace zero with 20, then what would happen is it would not be so sanguine. It would say, certainly not. 20 does not satisfy that predicate value equals zero, and so please go away. Okay, so far so good. There's no magic here, right? It's totally straightforward. Okay, the other thing to note is that I'm going to write refinements in this, what is this? I guess these are Haskell comments, right? And this was a kind of design decision where we intend this to be, what is the word? I think the word people use these days is an optional type system. So we want, you know, if you're not using our stuff, it's just plain old Haskell code, right? So everything's going to be, all the stuff that Liquid Haskell looks at is in comments. Okay, fantastic. So a lot of things are of type zero. I promise you we will move along. For example, 1 minus 1 is also of type 0, right? And this is because what's going to happen underneath the hood is, you know, I'm going to get an expression, 1 minus 1. There's no unification. We just throw it at the SMT solver. The SMT solver, we're going to ask it a question like, hey, I have in my hand a value that is equal to 1 minus 1. Does that imply that that value is equal to 0? Okay, and the SMD solver is going to say, yes, of course, I can do that. And so we don't get that little pink thing. Okay? Fantastic. Okay, good. So here's a slightly more interesting example. I might define the set of natural numbers, I would say type nat, you can call it whatever you like, but nat is a good name, is equal to value such that integer, such that the value is greater than or equal to zero. Right? And now I can say something like this. So I said we're only going to look at simple types, but I'm cheating. But you get the idea, right? I'm going to say nats is of type list of nat, right? And I have 0, 1, 2, 3 over there, right? All of those are, in fact, nats. Totally straightforward, right? So far, so good. Okay, let's move along. How about this? This is the first exercise, so I hope some of you are following along. Here's a type called pos, which actually looks just like nat, right? V colon in such that 0 less than equal to V. The first question is, can you fix pos so that, in fact, this variable POSS is rejected? Because I want this to only be the positive numbers, and clearly zero is not a positive number. So the question is, how should we fix the type of POS, the definition of POS, so that this first thing gets rejected? What's that? Remove the equal. Thank you very much. So let's remove the equal. So if I nuke that, and now I run it again, it's going to say, OK, I don't like that list anymore, because that's certainly not a list of positive numbers, right? If you're following along, you can also put your mouse over this little yellow check and it'll give you this, it'll basically say something like, this may be too much information at this point, but it's going to say, well, the type I have inferred for POS is blah, blah, blah. It's a list of things that are greater than or equal to zero, which is not a subtype of strictly greater than zero. We'll look at what this means in just a second, okay? But at any rate, the next part of the exercise was, can you modify POS so that now it is accepted using this definition of POS? Perhaps you can suggest what we would do, or anyone else for that matter. It's pretty obvious. Remove the zero, thank you. It's pretty straightforward, right? We don't like zero. That was the purpose of this whole thing. So let's remove our friend zero, and with any luck, everything is happy now. Okay? So, fairly straightforward, right? Yes?
Quick question. Is it possible, instead of removing equal, to just put one? Would that be an alternative?
To put one over here? Absolutely. So you might... Over here? Right. So we might have said this, if that's what you're wondering, right? And that would have had exactly the same result. And in fact, clickety-click, there we go, right? Okay, fantastic. So how exactly did this work? What is this, like, what just happened? Okay, so I don't want to get into too much detail about how this works, but still I want to give you a rough idea of what's going on, right? So let me give you a very high level overview of how refinement type checking works. The key thing to bear in mind is that unlike in, let's just say, usual type systems, a term can have many, many different types. And this is actually a very important thing, in my opinion, once you get into fancier types like this. So what do I mean? Let's go back to our friend zero. It already has two different types. The number zero satisfies the predicate value equals zero. It also satisfies the predicate value greater than or equal to zero, right? And maybe it satisfies a predicate that is even, and it satisfies a predicate that is between minus 5 and plus 5, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? So a term has many, many different types. I don't want to lock it in and give it a single type, okay? And so the way that we're going to connect all these different types is via a notion of subtyping, specifically what is called predicate subtyping. So here's what it means. I promise you there will be no more Greek after two more slides, okay? It'll just be Haskell. So what it means is that in an environment gamma, where an environment is just the list of variables currently in scope, right? I have variables x, y, z currently in scope. I say that if type T1 is a subtype of T2. That's just the definition, right? So when is a type T1 a subtype of T2? A type is a subtype of T2 if the following holds. So imagine I have a bunch of definitions in my currently in scope. I have variables x1, x2, x3, each of which satisfy some predicates or refinements p1, p2, and p3. I have a type something such that q is a subtype of something such that r if you conjoin all these pis, if you take their and you take q, that implies r. Okay? So for this reason, where did that piece of chalk go? We know that value equals 1 minus 1 is a subtype of value equals 0, right? Because value equals 1 minus 1 implies value equals 0. Pretty straightforward, right? There's no terrific magic. So let's look at why 0 has all these different types. Well, the reason 0 is of type NAT is because 0 satisfies value equals 0, which implies value is greater than or equal to 0. Okay, and so for this reason, we can actually end up viewing the same value at many different types. Okay? Okay, the nice thing about using SMT solvers is that we aren't going to have to fiddle around with these implications. And this is really where, this is in a sense where all the heavy lifting happens, right? You and I, that is to say the programmer, is not going to have to worry about does this imply that? Do I have to cast this into that? Do I have to convert something to the other? No, the SMT solver is just going to kick in and do all these implication queries for us whenever we need to. Okay, so we can just forget about when those things happen. Okay. So let's move on. So I just showed you these really simple things for like the number zero, a list of integers. Let's look at functions. And here's an interesting looking type. Okay? So let's stare at this for a second because it's slightly counterintuitive. What is going on here? So I'm defining a function called impossible. And impossible takes as input a string and it just calls error on that string. Okay? And the purpose of impossible is to be a function that basically denotes all those cases where I want to say this will never ever happen at runtime. Okay? So what I want to say is that this function should never ever be called. And the way I specify that is I give impossible an input type. So the thing v equals false is an input type. So by the way, just as Richard pointed out, GHC has these nice typed holes. We've also had them for a while. They're pretty convenient. So this is, we get to, not have to write the string. So here's what I'm saying. Impossible takes as input a string such that false and returns any A. And here's the deal. What satisfies false? Nothing satisfies false. Okay, and what that means is it is not, you cannot call the function impossible. Okay, so if your program type checks and it has impossible in it, you know that that particular thing is dead code and it will never happen. Okay, so let's use impossible. Here's a quick exercise. I want to write a safe division function, okay? I want to write a safe division function which takes two integers, it returns an integer. And what I want to do is I want to say that that particular case, safe div, is never called with the input zero. So can someone tell me how would I tweak the type of safe div to promise that I will never call safe div with a zero denominator? Are you sir? Excellent. So all I have to say is that the second one, the second int, cannot be zero, right? And there's various ways I might do that. So the simplest one is to say something like value colon int such that value is not equal to zero. Okay? So that would certainly work. And now we are guaranteed that So now what's going to happen is going to say, okay, you will never be called with zero. So what it knows is that essentially that zero case never happens. And the reason it all type checks is because what you know is that if D is not zero, D is not equal to zero, and when you do the pattern matching, what you get is and D equals to zero implies false. Right? Because that's a contradiction over there, which is why it says, okay, that you can call impossible, because in fact that's never going to happen. Okay, the falseness, the only thing that satisfies false or that implies false is false itself. Okay, so we've established a little contradiction there. So this might be slightly counterintuitive, but it kind of makes sense, right? You want to say that safediff is not called with zeros. Okay, fantastic. So as a consequence, these things work out quite nicely. Imagine I want to compute the average of two numbers. So I would say average 2 of xy I call is equal to safediff x plus y by 2. Right? This is going to work out because 2 satisfies the predicate not equal 0. Right? The reason it works out is that value equals 2 implies value is not equal to 0, which means the type value equals 2 is a subtype of value not equal 0. And so the type checker is happy about this. Does it make sense? Okay. Let me ask you this. Here's a quick exercise. So at this point, people are always, yes, 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 but where do you get these values from? In the real world, numbers come in from the user, right? So here's a little program. You could actually run this. Not that I will. It's not terribly exciting. What it does is it asks the user to enter a numerator, n. It enters a denominator, d. Right? So n and d are arbitrary numbers because the user is going to punch them in, right? And then it calls safediff nd. And so notice over here, the thing is not happy. Right? Why is it not happy? If we go and look at the error message, it'll say, well, here's the deal. The only thing I know about that d is that it's of the type integer such that value equals d. And I need it to be of type value not equal 0. And there's no reason for me to think that d is not equal to 0. Right? I can't prove that this implication holds. So what gives? So can anybody suggest how would we tweak calc so that this type checks? Is going to return something. Okay, and how would we write such a function? So fine, somehow you propose that we write a function, let's just call it foo, that takes as input some sort of integer or whatever, right? And then does what? It returns a maybe of an integer. I think it would just make it.
Well, an integer such that it's not zero.
Ah, it would have to return maybe of an int that's definitely not equal zero, okay? And then we should only call safediff if this function returned, right? A non-zero value. Okay, fine. So how would we write such a function? So foo of 0 would be nothing, presumably, right? And foo of, let's just say n, or whatever, d, let's stick with d, is just of d, right? And now maybe what I would do is I would write something like, here we go. Foo has the type, it takes as input an integer, and it returns as output an integer that is not equal to 0. Oh, and a maybe of that. Like so, right? Oh, and then of course we have to do some pattern matching and whatnot up here. How should we do that pattern matching? This is getting complicated, but you get the idea. Let's do it. Case, oh my goodness, foo d of nothing. So we want to say something like put sterling, shame on you. Okay, and if I get just of d prime or whatever, now I can do put sterling of just of d prime. Okay, fantastic. Let's see if that works. Sweet. Okay, the pinkness has gone away, so that should certainly make you quite happy, or makes me quite happy. There's also something simpler one can do, which has the same effect, more or less, which is to just put in an old-fashioned if statement, right? Oh, did I say statement? Oh, sorry. I meant an expression. I've been teaching undergraduates. Forgive me. Okay, you might just do something like if d is equal to zero. It has exactly the same effect, right? Then I would just say put sterling shame on you. Frankly, I prefer your solution, but I may as well show you this. Else put sterling the real thing. There we go. Did I get that wrong? Oh, right, there you go. It's grumbling that it doesn't know what the prime is.
And so because the logic is decidable, it can just figure out, that means d is never going to be 0 in the else branch, right?
Exactly. Or to cut a long story short, if you know a little bit about how GHC works is essentially it converts the thing that we have here into something that looks like a case of, right? So the way GHC works is all ifs are actually, they get converted into case, blah, of, true or false. And that's how it all works out, okay? Okay, fantastic. But either way it works. Fantastic. But now here's a bit of a bummer. Here's another version. So here's average, but I want to compute the average again for any list, right? So I have a list X's, I just want to compute the average of all of those. So I get total, which is the sum of all the elements in the list, and N is the length of the X's, and now it doesn't like it. Why is that? I mean, we can go and stare at the error message, but essentially it says, well, it's the length of the list X's, but I need it to be non-zero, and of course it could be zero, right? There's no reason it couldn't be zero. So can anyone make a suggestion? How can we appease this? Is there any way you can think of? See, what?
Oh.
Handle the empty list specially, right? We have to somehow special case on the empty list. Excellent. So in fact, that's what we'll do, okay? I'm going to write, I mean, I'll show you the real way to do this, but for now, let's try this approach, which is essentially what Gershom suggests. What I'm going to do is I'm going to write a size function that is guaranteed to return a positive number, okay? And the reason it's guaranteed to return a positive number is because we are pattern matching on the empty list, and we just somehow pretend it doesn't happen. We're like, trust me, I'm not going to call it, right? So of course, we really don't want to, so let me uncomment this. Okay, let's just uncomment it. Now, if we were to uncomment this, right? So what it's going to say is, well, sure, you'll only get back a positive number, but I can't make any bets about this impossible, right? But if we do this, okay, so let's leave it uncommented, and we'll come back and fix this in a second. If we do this, then one of the nice things that happens is I can now tweak this to be what? How shall I modify this code so that it works out? So remember, size is guaranteed to return a positive number, so how shall I fix average? It might crash, but let's assume that won't happen. Yes?
Change length to size.
Excellent. I simply change length to size. And now it's all good, okay? But of course, this is slightly sketchy because yeah, sure, it's not going to crash over here. This safe diff call is certainly safe. The value n is definitely non-zero, but we might end up with a problem over here, right? So really, what I want at this point is some way of saying, trust me, I will call average only with lists that are not empty. And if I can call average with lists that are not empty, then I can call size and be guaranteed that this horrible thing won't happen. Okay? So let's go on and see how that happens. Okay, fantastic. Details, blah, blah, blah. But here's a quick recap of this first section, which is I just showed you what a refinement type is. Just a very simple kind of thing, right? It's just a type with this little predicate slapped on. Then the way we specify properties is we just write functions with either input types or output types that are refined. If the input type is refined, then it means you must call the function only with values that satisfy that property. If the output type is refined, it means that the function is guaranteed to produce values that satisfy that property. And finally, the machinery of actually generating that this satisfies, that satisfies, is all handled by the SMT solver. Okay, so let's move on. Mumble. I know for a fact what the next file is called. Actually, I don't. So let's just go back over here and click on data types, right? So for those of you who are following, let's just hop on to the data types part of the show. Okay, so the problem we had was this. Let's just define, so let's just, you know, do everything from first principles as it were. You could do this with GHC's built-in list, but let's just, for the purpose of this workshop, do everything from scratch. What I'm going to do is I'm going to define a list type which has either the empty list called emp or cons, which, for better or worse, I've chosen a sequence of three colons. Single colon is taken by GHC for its own cons. Double colon is taken for types, and so well. So we're stuck with this three colons, right? So I'm assuming everyone's comfortable with this. Cons takes an A and a tail, which is a list of A's, and so on. Okay, so remember, the problem that we have is we want to somehow say that a given list is non-empty. Now, those of you who saw the Idris, we know a little bit about Idris or dependent types, you know that the usual trick for dealing with this is to index the type of a list with its length. That is not the approach I advocate, okay? And that's not what we're going to do. We're going to do something slightly different. And it's different in a very for an important reason. But we'll get to the reason later. Let me just show you what we do. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to let you write Haskell functions that have a very specific structure. And that structure is this. the Haskell functions with a single equation per data constructor, right? So for example, emp and const is a single equation. And the second important part of the structure is that all the things on the right-hand side, that is the definition of the functions, belong in the refinement logic. So for example, 0 is in the logic, plus is in the logic, 1 is in the logic, and length of x's is also in the logic. Because remember those things, those uninterpreted functions. If x is in the logic, then length of x is also in the logic. Okay? And we're going to call these things measures. It doesn't really matter what you call them. Okay? The important thing is that having defined these measures, we can now use them inside our function definition. So here's what's going to happen. And it's actually somewhat related to what Richard talked about, but here's what we're going to do. Really, when you define a measure, what happens is that it automatically changes the types of the data constructors under the hood. So what happens is, internally, LiquidHaskell knows that the type of emp is that it's a list of A, as before, but where the length is equal to 0, just from that definition. And for const, what it knows is const takes an A and a list of A's, and it produces as output a list of A's, but whose length is equal to 1 plus the length of X's. Okay? So it's kind of like the indexing, but not quite, and we'll discuss why that matters later. Let's just see what you do with these lengths. Okay, so here's how you use a measure. And rather than me telling you how to use a measure, why don't you tell me how to use it? So here's head and tail, which, you know, from birth we are trained not to use because they're notoriously partial. But can you tell me how we would tweak the signatures for head and tail so that these impossibles wouldn't happen? So right now, this is just the Haskell signature, right? List A goes to A, list A goes to list A. If I push play, it'll say, that's no good, because you might, you know, both of those cases might fire, right? So how can we tweak the signatures for head and tail to say, trust me, I will only call head with good lists, and I will only call tail with good lists? What would those good lists look like? What's that? Go on, length of something. Fantastic, there we go, right? So that's exactly what we do. We would just tweak this to say, C is as good as anything else, but why would we call it C? It's some list X's such that the length of X's is greater than 0. You could put in not equals as well, but you know, it's got to be greater than, right? And over here, you would do the same thing. List of A such that length of X is greater than 0. But now you notice we typed almost the same thing two times. And so instead, we might as well just define this thing as a separate alias, much like Haskell's aliases. So I would say type list, let's just say not empty, is equal to list of A. Okay, so list not empty is a list of A's such that, and I'm going to just copy and paste this. Womp, length X's, this should not be X's, this should be V. And there we go. And now I can change this to just be list not empty. And this can also be list not empty. Oh, thank you. There we go. And I really like these things to be lined up. And I'm kind of a white space bigot, so. Okay, there we go, right? So now those are all good, right? So I promise that I will only call head and tail with non-empty lists. And so now, of course, what I've done is I've shifted the burden of proof onto those functions that call head and tail, and they must now guarantee that when they call head and tail, should they, why would you call head and tail really, that the lists are not empty. Okay, so on this next slide, I'd actually define this alias. That's what we're going to use from now on. I like any for not empty. And here we go. So here's a function that's not as lame as head and tail, but which is nevertheless pretty useful in my opinion on occasion. I've used it. I will be the first to admit I've used this, right? It's fold R1. Okay, so fold R1 is fold R's little brother, where fold R1 assumes that the list actually has elements inside it. So fold R is good old fold right, right? ABB takes an initial B, a list of A's, and crunches you down to a single B. Fold R1 is a sort of simpler thing. It assumes that the list actually has one element in it, and it just uses that first element as the thing to start doing the folding from, right? So fold R1 has this very nice type, AAA, a list not empty, and you get back an A. So far, so good? Okay, fantastic. Let's move along. So now, let's see. How would we tweak the type of average so that it type checks? So there's a bunch of errors now, right? We're calling N. N calls length, so that may be non-zero. I call fold R1 with X's, but fold R1 also expects non-zero, non-empty lists. Let's see why it's grumbling over here. What is the problem? Same deal, right? Is not a blah, 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 is not a subtype of zero less than length, right? It requires a non-empty list. And that up there, we know what it's the old story for div, right? I need a denominator that's non-zero. So what is the simple fix? How do I tweak average to make it happy? List any, right? Sweet. So I just make this list any, and now we can go home. Okay, so there we go. Now let me make a brief digression, very brief, right? So since I just showed you the thing about list any, what we did is I said you have lists, you can define its length and so on, and I can say certain functions take lists that are empty or non-empty and so on and so forth. Often what we want to do is there's this very nice slogan, I like it a lot, making illegal states unrepresentable. So often you have invariants on your data, and you would like to tweak your type or define your type in a way that essentially it's impossible to construct invalid values of that particular data type, where invalid means those which do not satisfy some desired invariant. For example, and this is not the most compelling example, we'll see more interesting ones later in the talk, but I want to throw this out there. Imagine I wanted a data type that represents a sequence of values, one for every month of the year, right? So I would say data year of A is a year of a list of A's. But since it's supposed to be a year, follow me, humor me in this contrived example, I want to rig it so that that list has size exactly 12, right? So I don't want you to be able to say just a list with two elements. I want, like, it has to have all 12 elements, okay? So here's what you can do. What you can do is you can actually create a refined data definition. So the thing that's up on the top over here. And here what I'm doing is I'm defining a type alias called list of n that takes A, which is the thing it's a list of, and n, which is the size I want. It's a list of A such that length V is equal to n. And now what I'm going to say is data year A is simply a year of list n of A of 12. It's pretty obvious, right? But now the nice thing that I get is that illegal states have become non-representable. For example, this is a year that has just one element in it. That's no good, right? So the only way to fix this would be to actually put in 12 different elements. Does that make sense? Okay, so let's just work with these years for a little bit. So this is a slightly longer example, so let's work with this, right? So I want to write a function. So I'm defining a data type called weather. Weather has two fields, temperature and rain, okay? And what I want to do is, I want to write a function called temp average that takes as input a year of weathers and returns a single integer, which is going to be the average temperature for all the months of the year. Pretty straightforward, right? So what I'm going to do is I have year, which is a collection of months. I just call average on m's, months. Why m's and months? Well, the idea is I call the map function to suck out the temp from each month. Does that make sense? Yes, I'm just running map on each of these weathers to suck out the temp. I do map on that, and so what I want, and then I want to call that on average. So first of all, can someone tell me why is this not? What's the problem here? Why is it being? What's up with this pinkness? What's up with the error? Fantastic. So remember, average, our old friend average, oh, I may as well show you this. I was very proud of it when I got it to work. So remember, our friend average, we gave it the type that says it must take a list of integers that is greater than zero, length is greater than zero, and then it'll give you back an int, right? Because it was calling fold r and whatnot. So this is one of those cases where now on the call side, at the place where we call average, we need the list to be non-empty. Very well. And so now we don't know that months is non-empty, right? But we know that m's has length 12, so what gives? What's the problem? Map lost the type. Exactly, right? Map lost the type. And what is the type we want? We want to say that map takes as input, if you give map a list with 100 elements, and the output also has 100 elements, right? So, well, here we go. So the way I'm going to tweak the type of map is it takes X's, which is a list of A's. You get back a list of B's whose length is what? What shall I put in here? Exactly. It's, in fact, exactly equal to the length of this list X's, right? Length X's. Okay, so there we go. So now map, the type of map is going to change because we've given it this nicer type. Okay, so here we, oh, it scrolled off the top. Oh, it hasn't. Actually, it fits. A to B, X3, which is a list of A's, and you get as output a list of B's whose length is equal to the length of X3. Right? And so this is in fact, a dependent type in the sense that the output refers to the value of the input. Yes?
Is there a way to reuse the implementation of map without changing the
Is there a way to reuse? I'm not sure I follow your question.
Like,
oh, and can you later add on the length fact? Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
We would like to do that, but not yet. That's the short answer. So right now, you give it a type, and right. So if once you lose that information, it's gone. So for example, if I associate this map thing, if I, yeah, the short answer to your question, as I understand it, is not yet.
Can you define a map to function that has another liquid type to it?
And yes.
Use this map implementation.
Oh, for sure. But that won't type check. It will. So the way to think of it is, the way the type system works is currently is the way all type systems work, in the sense that the only information it knows about map at this call site is the information that's in the type of map. I have no idea how it was implemented, other than its type signature. So let's do exactly your experiment, right? So this is fine, in that I've defined map prime, it uses map, and so on, right? This is great, but if I go back over here, and I remove that the fancy type for map, then that's not going to be so good. I can't prove that, because the only information I have for map is whatever's in the type for map. Yeah? Yes?
So related to that question, does LiquidHaskell come with a prelude?
Yes, it absolutely does. I haven't described any of this. There's a whole preload. A lot of this, actually, it's a good thing you mentioned this, because I may as well. A whole bunch of stuff is in the prelude. Let's just scroll up and see if we can find something that's in the prelude. Here is our friend plus, for example. So things like plus are all just refinements of the GHC preludes plus. For example, let me just do this. I'm just going to say, and this is because ace doesn't like infix operators. I'm going to do blah, and I'm just going to put plus over here, and I'm just going to replace this with plus, right? Grind. But now if you look at the type for plus, it looks something like this. And this is pulled out of the prelude, right? This is just because the way plus is implemented is the GHC prims, mumble. And we have a prelude where we just say, assume this type for plus. OK, let's look at another example. Actually, this one is, OK, fine. This is an easy one. OK, init. So init, I remember I didn't want to type out all 12 months. I wanted to create an example of a year. So here's the San Diego weather. It's really easy because the average weather every month is more or less around 72. So I'm just going to say year init const 72 of 12, right? So it just creates a list. So the init function is the usual init function. You can Google it up. It's maybe slightly different. I give it a function from int to a, and I give it a nat, right? So I want to get back lists of that size. And if init of 0 is emp and init of f of n, it just creates the list, right? And the value that it creates for each n is f of n. So how would we, what is the right type for init over here? We want to capture the fact that if I give you some number n, it actually produces a list of size n, right? So I would just say n nat. This maybe makes you slightly happier. But here I actually have an n in scope, right? So we don't have indices. At any time when you want to write refinements, it's going to be over values that are in scope, okay? And blah, 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 this just becomes n, okay? That's totally straightforward, right? So now here's a slightly trickier version of that same map. And this is the kind of thing where it's actually really tedious to do if unification is your only type inference engine. So for example, try doing something like this in Idris. It's not impossible, it's just kind of irritating because you have to teach it a little bit of math, right? So here's init prime. It looks almost like init, except that instead of counting down from n to 0, it counts up from 0 to n, right? So I have this little loop called go. Starts off at 0, and go of I is, if I is less than n, f of I followed by mumble, go of I plus 1, and otherwise emp, right? So this is actually going to give me the months 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, which is probably what I want instead of backwards. But anyway, so now I would like to get exactly the same signature over here. I would like to say that if you give me a list of n, then in fact this output list has size, but it's not so happy. It's like, no, I can't prove that. I don't know that go in fact produces lists of Go of 0 returns a list of size n. What happened? Can someone explain how we would tweak this? How shall we make it happy? You and I know that it's... What's that?
You should give a signature to go, right?
And what should that signature be? How is Go behaving, do you think? So Go of I... So imagine n is... The way I think of it is, imagine n is 100. Go of 25 is going to return what? A list of size... Exactly. So you need to use subtraction in your signature. So if go of 25 is going to generate the list from 26 through 100, right? So of 75 elements. So in general, Go of I is actually going to return a list of size. So Go is going to take as input I don't know what I is, so I'll just like some I, and returns as output a list N of A's, I imagine. And how long is this? What's that?
Of size N minus I.
Of size N minus I, thank you. Oops. Okay. So there you go. Okay, so in fact, Go is going to give you back a list of size N minus I. And it's one of those things where, you know, is there, what if there was an off by one, like if I put this N minus I plus one, it's just like, no, I don't think so. Right? So you need to get it just right. Okay, fantastic. Okay? So I'm showing you this because it turns out that once you start, well, in the largest of the case studies, we'll see that this kind of thing happens again and again, right? You start filling in buffers from left to right, right to left, up to down, so on and so forth. So it's nice to be able to just do structural recursion on NATs starting from N to go down, but it's also nice to be able to go up sometimes. And that's another handy thing that you want to just throw at the SMT solver, because to them, it doesn't really matter which way you're going. Okay, fantastic. So this is it as far as the sort of first part of the show is concerned. Just, I've shown you basic refinements. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you three, let me just call them quote-unquote case studies, which use these to, you know, not for quite so contrived examples. So the first one is not contrived really, it's insertion sort, okay, it is contrived. The second one is slightly less contrived, and finally I'll show you one of my favorites, which is just low-level memory. Okay, so let's get started. So here's the first of the little case studies. Insertion sort. So what exactly is insertion sort? I'm hoping everyone knows, but if not, just to refresh your memory, this is how insertion sort works, right? Let's say I'm going to call the function sort. It takes a list and it returns a list. Ignore those type signatures because they obviously don't type check. But it takes a, oh, they do type check actually, list of A to list of A. And the insert function is where all the heavy lifting happens, right? Insert takes as input a single element, a list of the elements that have already been sorted, and it takes the element that you gave it and sort of plonks it in at just the right place inside the list that you supplied. Okay? Okay, fantastic. And the way it works is like so. If you have x and you want to insert it into the empty list, it's just x cons emp, you just stick it in. If you have x and y's, then you compare x and y's, you check, is x less than y? If so, aha, x goes at the very beginning and the rest is y cons y's. And otherwise, we know that x goes somewhere inside the list, and so I put y as the head and then I recursively insert x into y's. Okay? Fantastic. So, what do we want to do with insert sort? What is the quote-unquote case study? So let's do three different things. The first thing I would want to say is that it has the output has the same size as the input. Okay, so that's going to be pretty easy. It's pretty much the same thing we've seen before, right? The second thing I want to say is slightly more interesting. I want to say that the output list has the same set of elements as the input. Okay? And finally, what I want to say is that, well, in fact, it is a sorted list. The list, you know, the values are produced in increasing order. So let's see how these three things work one by one. Okay, so the first property is size. So let's see, can we fix the type of insert, the insert function, so that this actually type checks? If I push play here, it's not going to type check, it's going to grumble about one thing or the other. So here what I want to say is that the sort function takes as input a list x's and produces as output a list whose length is exactly equal to that of x's. But right now it says, no, I don't think so, I can't prove that over there. And clearly, well, it's not so clear, but it's not impossible to see that the problem probably has to do with what insert returns. Because if you look at the type of insert, it says, you give me an A, you give me a list of A's, I give you back some random list, right? So what do you think we should say for the type of insert so that we would be guaranteed that, in fact, insert sort produces a list whose length is exactly equal to that of X's? What's going on? Thank you. Okay, so it takes the old list and drops x somewhere in the middle, right? So it's whatever the old list was plus one more element. Okay, so that's pretty easy, right? So list of n, 1 plus length x's.
Would there be any downside to doing the xs equals n, like the length equals that minus 1?
Over here? Yeah. The downside would be, so that's a very, very interesting question. The reason I can't say anything over here is it's somewhat of a technical point. I can't refer to values in the output because technically they're not really in scope. You see what I'm saying? So I can't say the input is one less than the output. I mean, there's no fundamentally important reason why you can't do that. But right now you can't, right? I can allow the outputs to refer to the inputs, but right now we don't allow the inputs to refer to the outputs, okay? Okay, there was no hand. Okay, so that was super easy, right? So let's move on and let's look at this more interesting question of the elements. How do I guarantee that in fact the output list has the same set of elements? And here I'm going to actually tell you a little bit more about these SMT solvers. The main thing I'm going to tell you is just like they can reason with integers, they can actually also reason about sets. Okay, so the theory of sets is, what do I mean by the theory of sets? I mean with the operators empty, union, intersection, complement, blah, 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 right? All of this is completely decidable and has been since like 1922. Okay, and modern SMT solvers implement these theories. And so here's what we're going to do. I am going to let you write set valued measures. So just like we said, here's a list and you can write a function that tells you how long it is. You can also write functions for what is in the set. Okay, so, and just to make this convenient, we sort of expose this as with refined signatures for the functions in data set. Okay, so how does one do this? Well, let me just demonstrate. Here's how you specify the elements of a list. So just like we said measure length, I can say measure LMs of a list. And the measure LMs is a function. The empty list returns s.empty, set.empty, right? And for cons, I return add LM xx's, where add LM is simply, how do I add LM to x and x's? Well, take the singleton x and union it with the LMs recursively in x's, okay? And this, all of this happens to belong, again, in the refinement logic because union, singleton, blah, 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 all of these are in the sort of theory of sets. SMT solvers can sort of chew this up for breakfast. Okay, so inline just lets us write this as Haskell code. And now let's see how we would use these as, let's see how we would use them inside our insertion sort, okay? So here's a variant of insert sort where I now want to check, so just like I defined list n, list whose length is equal to n, I'm defining list e, which is a list whose elements are equal to s, right? A list whose elements are exactly equal to whatever s is. So now what I want to say is that sort e takes as input a list x's and returns as output a list whose elements are equal to those in x's, right? But of course, I can't because insert e doesn't have the right type, right? Insert e as before is lame. It says you give me an x, you give me an x's, and I give you back a random list. So can somebody tell me, perhaps you, how would we tweak the type of insert e? I'm just picking on people. Just like a natural. How would we tweak the type of insert e so that it let us prove that sort e in fact does the right thing? It's the same idea. I'd use union. So what am I unioning? I'm unioning x to the elements of x's, right? So basically the output elements of insert are whatever's in x's plus the element x, which is to say, this is why I conveniently wrote it as a separate function, add lm, that we might reuse, right? So here what I would say is the output is simply list e of add lm x x's. Okay, so it's the equivalent of 1 plus length x's. Whoops. Grind, 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 and there we go. Okay, so now we have that the output list of sort, in fact, has exactly the same set of elements as the input. Okay, but we said sorting, and I've said nothing in the types about how we might actually order the elements in the list, right? So how do I specify that the output list is in fact ordered? As it happens, I've told you the answer earlier, but let's just see how we get there, right? So often you have to be a little creative in how you can use these primitives. So let's recall our old friends, the refined data type. So that whole thing about year where I said a year must have 12 months. Let's just go and revisit that idea for a second, okay? So let's just do the following exercise. Imagine I want to write an ordered pair type. So an ordered pair has an OP of x and an OP of y, both of which are integers. And what I want to specify, for no good reason, is that the legal values are such that OP of x is strictly less than OP of y. Okay? So I want to say that OP of 2, 4, that's legal, but OP of 4, 2, not allowed. Okay? Because I want the x to be strictly less than the y. Okay, very well. How would you do this? Can you think of how we might tweak the data definition or write a refined data definition that would that would tell us that OP of Y must be less than OP of X? Sorry, greater than OP of X? Sorry, say that again? Can we put that in the type that? Yes, and what is your suggestion? Was it the same?
Well, more concretely, I was going to say add a predicate on OPY that says that it needs to be greater than OPF.
Fantastic. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to say OP of Y must be some integer such that OP is a value that is strictly greater than OP of X.
But just out of curiosity, would it be possible to inverse, or do we need to put it in order? So if we put it on OPX, can I reason about OPY?
If we put it on OPX, it's kind of the same thing. And the reason why is, let's see why. Let's see if I can explain why. Here's the deal. When you create these refined data constructors, what really happens is the following. Let's go and see what the type of OP is. Oh, it's not working. Damn it. Lost it. Huh? Why not? Oh, JavaScript. This is why I wanted to be at that pure script thing, by the way. But anyway. What's really going on, I need the eraser, I can never find erasers, is underneath the covers, each of these refined data definitions is actually, remember in Haskell, when you create a data type like that, you end up with OP becomes a function, the constructor function, that is of type int to int to whatever, odd pair or whatnot. Right? And so when we have these refined data types, what's really going on is we just get a refined function, right? So this becomes now, this is called OP of X, and this becomes some OP of Y such that, OP of Y must be greater than OP of X, right? And so what that means, and this is the way we enforce that you can only create legal values, because whatever you pass into the constructor must satisfy the invariants, right? And as a consequence, what happens is, to get back to your question, later things can refer to earlier things. This is one of the recurring themes in this sort of dependence setting. Output can refer to this input and this input. This fellow can refer to this and so on and so forth, right? But I can't get this to refer to these things in the future. Again, there's no fundamental reason for this. It's just the way it's set up right now. It just turns out to be the easiest. Okay, fantastic. So this is also legal, right? So this is how we have ordered pairs. Here's another example of the same thing. So returning, okay, so CSV, right? So I want to create a CSV type. And the CSV type, I'm currently in the middle of making some exams, so this is what popped into my head. I have a bunch of headers, which are strings, right? For example, student ID, midterm score, final score. And I have a bunch of values, one for each student. So they have the student 1, 25, and then 88, et cetera, et cetera, right? But what I would like is for my CSV, for my legal values, to not have any holes in them. Okay, so I don't want, oh, I forgot the midterm score for one student or so on. So I somehow want those to be flagged, okay? So how can we tweak? Can you tell me? So here's a CSV value that has a hole in it for some reason, right? I forgot or something happened and I've left this out. So how can I modify the CSV type so that it enforces this legality that if I have five headers, each list has five things inside it? Exactly, right? So I just say each of these is a list of integers that is equal to the length of headers, right? Okay, so now when I do this, you get the idea, right? It's going to grumble and this whole thing will turn pink when it comes back. Come back. Let me blame the network for this. I don't know what's going on here. But you'll have to, oh, there we go. Okay, so that the whole thing is rejected. Okay, good. So now with this little refresher on ordered lists, let's see how we can tweak the list data type to ensure that you only create increasingly ordered lists, okay? Here's the deal. So here's, I'm going to create a slightly different data type for lists. I'll just call it OList for ordered list. OEMP, and I have a const, and I put this little frowny face over there just to indicate that it's going upwards from left to right, right? And there's an O head and an O tail. The O head is an A, the O tail is an ordered list. And here's the trick. I'm going to now ensure this ordering becomes a legal constraint, like so. Okay, so check it out. What I'm going to say is that a head is whatever A, but inside the tail, I only have elements all of whom are greater than the head. Right, so in every tail, so the tail is an O list of values of type A such that that value is greater than O of head. Okay? It's the same machinery as before, right? The same CSV, the same ordered pair. All I'm saying is that recursively, the tail elements are all greater than the head. And as a consequence, here we go. This is just fine. 1, 2, 3, that's ordered. But this is not so good. 1, 3, 2, nope, can't do that. Okay? And of course, if I now change this from 1, 3, 2 to 1, 3, I don't know, 25, then it's all good, right? Because at each level, the numbers are going up. And as and when this comes back, I don't know why things have suddenly become so sluggish. There's no telling. It'll come back. It'll come back. What? There you go. Okay, it's gone. And so here we go. We're back to our insertion sort. Sort of O, so this is now, it actually has order as well. So sort of O takes as input a list X's, produces an output list, which is an ordered list of elements, which has the same elements as X's. And so here the element part is fine, but it doesn't like this. Can somebody tell me what's the problem? I want to say that insert produces an ordered list, but it doesn't like me. What's going on? Well, you want to look closely at the code here. If X is less than Y, then who should be at the beginning of the list? Okay. So you actually want X over here, and you want Y over here. And now when you do that, it's going to be all fine. Okay. Grind, grind, come on. Why is this being so tedious? You just blame the regents of the University of Colorado. Okay, so here you go. Long story short, here is insert sort. It looks pretty much like the insert sort we had. Like it is the same insert sort that we had at the beginning, right? Except that now I have the guarantee that it's the same set of elements, and it is in fact they are in fact in increasing order. Now, since Richard has stepped out, I can rein a little bit on singletons. I don't want to rein on singletons. I mean, somebody just asked me this question. What is really the difference between this versus something like Idris? The main difference is this. Languages like Idris and Coq and so on are infinitely, literally more expressive because you aren't limited to this dinky little refinement logic, right? So the trouble here is that you're limited to the refinement logic. But on the plus side, by virtue of being limited to the refinement logic, there's a whole bunch of stuff you don't have to write, okay? So for example, this is the insertion sort in Haskell, right? And you get all those guarantees. Here is an insertion sort in Idris, which is significantly more involved. And these don't have to do with, like, some of this is just boilerplate because you have to describe length and sets and so on, right? But even if you throw that aside, you have to do a whole bunch of work just for, you know, this is, if X is less than Y and Y is less than Z, then things are transitive. The elements are the same, flip, I'm not really sure what's going on, and maybe this person is not the best Idris programmer, but I think he's pretty reasonable. But I think it's pretty clear that this is a significantly more involved example than, or the code here is rather more complicated than what we had than what we had here, right? And my purpose there is not to rein on Idris, but just to demonstrate there's a whole bunch of stuff we're getting for free from the SMT solver. Because really what's happening in that Idris code is that the programmer is essentially generating these proofs or writing these proofs, manipulating these proofs in their program, which we don't have to because they're all in this nice theory and we just get those for free, right? And so I guess my point is this, the way I view the world is, I was just explaining this to a person, which is I'm sort of down in this space where I assume I want everything to be automatic, and then I want to just improve, I want to figure out how can I improve my expressiveness? How much more can I pack in while remaining completely automatic? While in the Idris world, they start with just always maintaining arbitrary expressiveness. And what they're trying to figure out is how can you improve the automation, right? And hopefully there's some point at which we'll meet. Okay, I do want to point out one more thing, which is, I mentioned this earlier, which is this business of multiple measures. So notice we did this thing, which is again slightly different than what one does in the dependent, in the sort of classical dependent style where you index a list and you say this for all n, right? So I took the same list A, and I gave you a function length, and I gave you another function lms, right? So these are two different measures that I wrote for it. And the way it works out is quite nice, actually, because we're in this nice refinement land. You can write down five measures if you like. Remember how I said length just gives you this extra predicate that goes into the data constructor? Well, you can have five extra predicates. They just all get conjoined. You just and. Okay? And the nice thing about this is that I don't have to bake in any invariants a priori into my data structures. So I can have lists and I can view them. I care about lengths. I can care about sets. I can care about various different properties of that same data type. And this actually lets me reuse a whole bunch of code. Okay, let's move on and instead move to a slightly more interesting example, which is the well-scoped eval. So let's look at a second example. What time is it? 25. Okay. which is, let me tell you about associative maps. So here's the problem. I alluded to it at the very start of the talk. Imagine you have a map, Haskell, lazy JavaScript. If I look up Python, I get this nasty exception, right? So can we at compile time ensure that these kinds of things will not happen? So here's what we're going to do. We're going to use the same set business to describe the set of keys that are in fact defined in the map. Okay, and then we're going to use measures to ensure that every time you look up an associative map, the set of keys is in fact present. Okay, and so I'll describe how that works, and then I'll show you a little evaluator, quote unquote, which is, think of it as Richard's evaluator, but like a really Mickey Mouse version of it, where all I'm going to guarantee that is that you have well scoped, that you don't have sort of variable non-bound errors at runtime. Okay, so here's a very simple associative map definition. It looks just like the list. You could implement this with binary search trees and so on, but you know, just to keep things quick, I'm just going to implement it as a list. So a map kv is either empty, or you bind the key k to a value v, and then you recursively have a tail map kv, right? Fantastic. So the way we are going to ensure that we don't get any of these key not found in the map is by designing, by writing a measure called keys, which describes exactly the set of keys that are defined in the map. Okay? The empty map is going to have the empty set of keys. The lookup function is essentially going to say, you give me a key k, but the map you give me to do the lookup must have that key k. And I'll describe what this has looks like in a second. The insert function is going to take a key and a value and a map, and is going to give as output a new map whose keys are equal to the old map plus the key k. Okay, so we'll very precisely track the set of keys in a map inside the type system, such that anytime we do a lookup, it's guaranteed to succeed. Okay, so let's see how we do that. We've pretty much already seen this, right? The way I can define the set of keys of a map is quite straightforward. The empty map has the empty set of keys. If I have a binding from key to whatever value, I don't care. I just add the key k to the bindings of m, where add is just like add lm, right? Just recursively compute the bindings that are in m and add k to that set, add the singleton k. The empty map, it just looks like this. The keys of m is empty. Okay? Set emp is a predicate that just says the keys of that particular map are empty. Okay, how do we add a key to a map? It looks like this. The insert function just sticks that key in front of all the other bindings, right? So if I want to insert a key k to a value v and the map m, I just say bind kvm, so I just stick it in front. And the type that I have for insert is something like, given a key and a value and a map, the output map, the set of keys in that output map is equal to add of km, where add of k is just this thing, right? Take the singleton k and union it with the keys already in kvs. Okay, so it's just like the thing we saw for lists earlier. Okay, this is the interesting one. So I'm going to turn it into an exercise. Here's the lookup function. Okay, so the lookup function takes as input a key k prime and a map, which is either bind kvm or empty, right? And what I want to guarantee is that the impossible never happens. So I want to say that anytime you call lookup, you should only do so with keys that are guaranteed to be in the map. And so the way I'm doing that is I'm going to write a predicate called hasKM that says that the key k is in the map m. And what I've done over here is I've given you a bogus definition of has, which is just true. Right? So has is a predicate, takes a key, a map, and returns a boolean. And right now it's bogus, right? I've just written true, I could have written undefined. So let me ask you a question. How should we modify has so that we are guaranteed that the impossible will not actually happen? What do you think is a valid definition of has? Fantastic. There we go. Okay, so I'm just going to tweak this and I'm going to say s.member k. So k must be a member of what? Of keys of m. End of story, right? Pretty straightforward, right? So now if I say, I'm just going to define has, the lookup is guaranteed to never fail, right? And why is that? It's the same thing as before. If we know that k is in the map m, we already know that the empty map, well, when I say we already know, it's the SMT solver that knows this, right? Just from the definition of sets. That, remember, keys of empty is equal to the empty set. Nothing is in the keys of the empty set. There's your contradiction, right? So if you know for a fact that k is in, that has of km, that is to say, you know that this predicate is true, then there's no way that this last thing can trigger. Does this make sense? Okay, so again, there's a whole bunch of stuff that's just sort of happening under the hood, but it's really just math. There's nothing terribly complicated about this. Okay.
Do we need to put the inline has?
Yes, and this is a yes. The short answer is that, the short answer is yes. But it, the inline just lets us, so I can give you, it's a bit of a history lesson. Earlier, all these things, all these little expressions like s.member and so on, they were all inside the green stuff. They were all just, here are little predicates that are in the logic and you have to define them in the green stuff. For reasons, for various reasons, we would like all these things to just be Haskell code. And so here what we're saying is, here's a, just a raw Haskell function, and I intend to use this inside my specifications, and hence we write this little inline. That it's all, exactly. And if it's not, then it'll like grumble and curse. Exactly. The inline has is going to make sure that, yes, you may use this. There's nothing weird going on. Right? Sorry, was there a question? Yeah, so that's the purpose of the inline has. But I will say this is a relatively recent feature, so yes.
Since by the refinement type, you know that you can't call, that basically that bottom line will never be executed,
mm-hmm.
Why do you have to include it?
Oh, thank you. I don't at all have to include it. I can just delete it. I'm just including it purely for exposition. So, I'm including it for exposition. There's a minus totality flag, which would, even if you delete them, would actually check that you've checked all the cases and would grumble, right? So I'm including them just for exposition. Okay. So can anyone suggest what, here's by the way, so I promised that these errors would go away now at compile time. So I'm creating a little map called langs. Here's a map called langs, which binds Haskell to lazy, binds JavaScript to eager, right, an emp. And now I'm looking up Haskell in langs, that's fine. There's no pinkness there. But if I call lookup Python on langs, then it's a not allowed, because remember, pi is not in the keys, right? It's actually interesting. What is in the keys? What exactly is the type of langs? Let's just see. It's probably something gross. But here, it's not terribly gross. It's not horrible. Here you go. What you get is set mem hs in keys of value and set mem js in keys of value and something, 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 and value is equal to langs, right? So this is not... This is just a simple example because in reality, of course, who knows what's inside a map, right? It's a silly example because I'm just putting two things in, so it's not unreasonable that the type system would catch it. But next, I'll show you an example where we use the same. We're going to use exactly this map, but we have no really idea. It's not like there's one or two things in the map, right? It could be some unbounded set. But how would we fix this? So the typo over here is, well, Python is not there, right? So if I just change this, for example, to JS. Then it's going to be all fine, right? Because now the lookup function is appeased because we know that JS is in fact inside langs, okay? Okay, so now let's look at a slightly more interesting application of this same associative map trick. Well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and write a well-scoped evaluator. So Richard had this nice thing where he was using Debrayen indices. So instead of using Debrayen indices, we're just going to do it the old-fashioned way, right? We'll have names of variables, and we're going to use these associative maps to make sure that we don't have variable not found errors. So here, as I said, it's a really Mickey Mouse version of what he had. I was not lying. So a variable is just going to be var, v of string, okay? And an expression is either a value, which is an int, or a var of var, right? So a string. Or it's a plus of two expressions, and this is the interesting case, right? A let binding that binds a variable to some expression in some other sub-expression, okay? Okay, so first of all, this is just a little digression, right? You can in fact define, so when you have ADTs, you can define subsets of those ADTs by using measures. For example, I can define a type called val, which corresponds to those expressions that are in fact values. So that is, say, fully reduced, right? So a fully reduced expression is simply the one that is val under val of some number, right? So I would just write a predicate, is val expression to bool, is val of val is true, and is val of everything else is false, right? So nothing else, if it's a variable, if it's a let in, that's not a value. And now I can define vals to be just all those expressions such that is val of v is true. Okay, so let's see how you would use that. So here's another simple example of this kind of totality checking, right? So I'm writing a plus function. The plus function should only be called with two vals. So val I and val j, and it should return a val, which is I plus j. And you can see you get this nasty red thing, impossible plus. Of course, if I call it with two arbitrary expressions, I might very well get the impossible might happen. But if I promise to only call you with vals, then we know for sure that these other cases are not going to fire. Right? And the output is also just a val. Okay? So that's a simple one. Now what I can do is I can describe environments. So I'm going to evaluate, build an evaluator for the expressions. And the way the evaluator is going to work is it's going to map for the, so every time I say let x equals expression, let y equals expression, I'll keep adding to my environment the values of x and y. And the environment, therefore, is going to be a map from variables to values. Right? X got evaluated 10, y got evaluated 12, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so here's what I get. Here is my evaluator. It looks quite straightforward. If I have a value, you just return I. If I have a var of x, you look up x in the environment g. If I have a plus, you can just call plus. If I have a let x equals e1 in e2, I'm going to first evaluate e1 using the environment g, call that value v1. I'm going to insert x v1g, where insert is the same insert for our map. And then I'm going to use this new map gx to evaluate e2. Right? This is pretty much the obvious way you would write an evaluator for this. The only thing is that this lookup is like, what if I don't know about this? Remember, this looks up, it's that same lookup function from before. It's like, how do I know x is really in the environment? And in fact, it may not be in the environment, right? Maybe I wrote a function, suppose I just write an expression x plus 5. I don't know what the value of x is, so how can I guarantee that the bad thing won't happen? When I see x plus 5, I'll try and evaluate x, and I have no idea what x is. So somehow I want to rig it so that my evaluator only is well-formed, right? Is well-scoped. I don't have these variables. I don't use variables that are not defined. So it's a pretty non-trivial invariant. And let's see how we would express that. So check it out. What I'm going to do, how many people here know what a free variable is? Okay, a non-trivial number. I'll have a quick explanation later. The high-level bit is, for each expression, I just want to compute which are the variables that are not, in fact, defined inside the expression, right? Whose values need to come from the outside. And this is pretty much the textbook definition of a free of the free variables of an expression, right? So free is a function from expression to a set of variables. The free variables of value is empty because there's no variables in that. The free variables of var x is just the singleton x. The free variables of e1 plus e2 are compute the variables of e1 that are free, compute those of e2 that are free and take their union. The free variables of let x equals e1 in e2 is recursively compute the free variables of e1, compute the free variables of e2, and then it's the variables of e2 minus the variable x, because x goes out of scope, right, after you evaluate e2, and union that with the free variables of x as 1. Okay, so this is just how you define the set of free variables of an expression. And so here's an example, right, if that made no sense. Imagine I had an expression, let x equals 10 in x plus y. Then x is defined, because I say let x equals 10, but that y is free. Right? Y is not actually defined anywhere. And so I would represent that expression something like this. And if I compute free of E1, I would get this Y. Right? Yeah, did you have a question, Gershon? It's all good so far? Right? And so really what I want to say is that whenever I call this evaluator, I must in my environment have values for all the variables that appear free inside that expression. Right? So I would define that like so. I would say a scoped expression in G, where G is an environment, is an expression E such that E is well-scoped under the environment G. And what is this well-scoped? Well-scoped is simply a predicate that says, so well-scoped is a predicate that takes an environment and an expression and returns a Boolean, and it says that well-scoped of GE is true if the free variables of E are contained inside the free variables of G. Are contained inside the keys of G. Right? So all the variables that appear free inside E are in fact defined in the environment. That's all it's saying. Right? And we say that E is a scoped expression in the environment G if well-scoped GE holds. Pretty straightforward, right? Okay, so now that you have all this, can somebody tell me how we would tweak, how shall we fix the type of eval so that that lookup succeeds? How would I modify this type of eval? What kind of expressions can I call it with? Yeah. Yes?
Expressions such that it's also called
in the environment I pass in, right? Pretty straightforward. So I would name this environment. Let me call it G. And this would not be any random expression. It must be an expression that is a scoped expression in G. Okay? And so in this case, I'm not putting two variables inside it. This is just, I don't know what variables are inside the environment. But the expression I'm going to give you, all its free variables must be contained inside G. Okay? Okay, so let's look at another exercise. Same deal, right? So scoped expression, how about this? Suppose I want to write a function that works with any expression. So just like the thing we had at the beginning for the calculator. Yes?
It still says errors.
Which error? Where? You still get an error? It looks, shall I look at your laptop? Let's see. Plus, oh, that's a different error. This is just the plus. You probably didn't fix the type of plus. And furthermore, you haven't fixed your, you see, you have val exper.
Oh, okay.
So what it's complaining about is, so you should think about that. Why don't you meditate on that? Output type is also a val. So plus takes two vals as input and returns as output a val. That's the thing that you're missing. So you should change the output type not to be an arbitrary exper, but in fact a val. Okay. Sorry about that. Blah, blah, blah. Where was I? Okay, let's go back to this one. So here I want to write a safe eval that's going to work for any expression and for any environment G. But as you suggested at the beginning, we want to do some kind of option trickery. So I want to say that, look, you give me a G and an E. I'm going to check if E is OK. And if it's OK, then I'll evaluate G and E, right? And otherwise, I'll say nothing. No, you can't run this. Not allowed. So what do you think is a good definition of OK over there? What should we plug in? What's a good runtime check to put in? What else, right? Well-scoped. All we say is that you must be well-scoped GE. Okay? So if, in fact, you are well-scoped, then you may call eval, and then everything is great. Okay? Fantastic. So, right. So just this was a quick exercise where we use sets to track the set of keys inside a map. I'm using this kind of lame associative maps where you just add them in. You can actually, you can imagine implementing the same map as is done in, say, data map as a balanced binary search tree. And you could use all this machinery to, in fact, check that it satisfies this set interface in pretty much the same way. But you have to deal with the ordering constraints and so on, right? Okay, so we're on to the very last part of the show, but I feel a little break is called for at this point, or shall we? Okay, so let's do the last of these. Let's do the last of these. So the first two were somewhat, well, not somewhat. They were pretty academic exercises. But the last one, I think, is actually something one would actually want to do in practice. So what am I referring to? So what we did is we took LiquidHaskell and we essentially tried to use it to show that sort of widely used libraries like bytestring and text don't have buffer overflows. And what does that boil down to, right? So I alluded to this at the very beginning. It's perfectly possible to have things like heartbleed in Haskell. And in fact, you know, you could try this at home. So here's a function you might write on top of, which one was this? Text. No, bytestring. Where it's a function that takes a string and an integer and gives you back a string, right? The idea is to sort of suck out the first 10 characters. And chop sn, what it does is it takes the string s and it packs it into a bytestring. Let's call it b. And then what you do is you call this unsafe take function, which is a fast take function, if you wish, that sucks out n characters from b. That gives you a bytestring b prime. And then you unpack b prime to get back s prime, and you return it at the top, right? And as it happens, if you try and run this, if you pass in, you know, the right values, you win. You get the substring. But if you don't, you don't. You know, bad things can happen. So for example, if I try something like let x is equal to Ranjit loves burritos, and I say chop x of 10, then I get Ranjit love, right, which is a prefix. But if I, you know, instead of 10, if I put something that's much, much longer, then weird things start to happen. It won't crash. It'll happily tell you what comes after Ranjit loves burritos. Okay? And this is the kind of thing you would want to make sure doesn't happen if you're using a nice language like Haskell. Okay, so here's going to be our plan. Okay, so this is the kind of thing where it's quite difficult to just use Haskell's native type system to prevent this kind of overflow. But what we're going to do is we're going to use refinement types, okay, to dress up the type system to prevent this sort of thing from happening. And here's the general strategy, and this is really how one uses something like LiquidHaskell, or actually any type system. It's how you would design, how you would design a type system to solve a problem like this. So something like bytestring is, you know, there's a whole layer, right? Bytestring itself is a kind of sits in the middle. Below it is GHC's low level sort of interface to pointers and memory, often which is where you tinker with that in C, right? So there's a very low level pointer API. Bytestring builds on top of that pointer API, and things like chop build on top of bytestring. Okay, so what we're going to do is we'll start at the lowest level, and we'll write nice types, and at each level we'll write interesting types, and we'll sort of check those types using the types at lower levels. Okay, So let's start at the very beginning, which is the low-level pointer API. So some of you might be all over this, but for those of you who aren't, here's a quick sort of refresher, right? So this is how the GHC's low-level pointer API works. There's something called a data pointer A. It's a pointer to things of type A. And there's something else called a foreign pointer, and it's not terribly important what the distinction is. A high-level bit is a foreign pointer wraps around a pointer and it can be sort of exported to and from C. Right? There's some various details about how this works. But high-level bit is there are these two pointer types. And the way you interact with these pointers is that GHC gives you this kind of interface. I'm simplifying things dramatically, right? So there's a function to read the value of a pointer that takes a pointer, returns an IOA. Peek, there's a version that writes a pointer, right, called poke, that takes a pointer, the new value you want to write, and you know, does the IO action. And finally, the way you actually work with these pointers is you do a whole bunch of pointer arithmetic. So there's something that, let's just call it plus pointer, that takes a pointer, some offset, and sort of moves the pointer along by that particular offset. Okay? And finally, the way you actually create pointers in the first place is you have functions that are the equivalent of malloc. There's definitely a missing IO there, but never mind. Okay, so malloc takes some number, 45, and gives you a pointer to a buffer of 45 bytes, right? And finally, the way you actually do things with foreign pointers is there's a function called withForeignPointer, which you give it a foreign pointer, right, from your application. You give it some sort of callback or continuation or whatever you want to call it, that where this function is going to unwrap that foreign pointer into a pointer, run this function on that particular pointer, and it'll give you back an IOB. Okay? So this is, roughly speaking, the sort of lowest level API that is exposed for manipulating pointers. So here's an example. That was a lot of detail. Here's an example. So what this does is it allocates a block of 4 bytes and writes a bunch of, it writes 4 zeros into it. So here's 0, which is a word 8. What I'm doing is I create a foreign pointer FP by calling malloc of 4. And then I have this with foreign pointer FP. I call this action. What does that action do? It's a lambda p, so p is the unwrapped pointer. Do poke p plus pointer 0, so at the position 0, write a 0, at the position 1, write a 0, position 2, write a 0, position 3, write a 0. Right? And what we would like to make sure is that, so this is fine, because I created a pointer with 4, of size 4, and so I should be able to write these things to it. But if instead of 3 over there I had 30, then that would not be so good. Because then, who knows which part of memory I'm mucking with over there, right? So what I'd really like to do is to set up my type so that if I said the block has 4 bytes, then you can only write at position 0 to 3. You can't just write at position 30, okay? So let's see how we might do that, okay? So the high-level bit is very similar to what we've been doing so far. It's just slightly more complicated because there's a few more moving parts. What we're going to do is we're going to refine the pointers. So each pointer is now going to carry with it information that says how many bytes are remaining in the buffer that it points to. Okay? And then what we'll do is in the various pointer operations, we'll make sure we track exactly what those sizes are. Okay? So for example, here's what it looks like. So again, these are all things that are implemented in C, right? So we just have to assume these types. So for example, I'm going to track the size, I'm going to create two measures, pLen and fpLen, that tell me how much space remains in a pointer and in a foreign pointer, right? So many bytes remain. And I'm going to say that a pointer of n is a pointer that points to a block that contains n remaining bytes, and the same for foreign pointers. Okay? Now what I'm going to assume is that when I create a pointer with malloc, I must pass in a nat, so I can't create a pointer with like minus 5 bytes in it. I must pass in a nice nat. And what I get as output is a foreign pointer that has exactly n bytes remaining, right? And what the with foreign pointer operator does is you give me a foreign pointer, and I will now run it, I will unwrap it, and I'll give you a pointer whose size is exactly equal to that foreign pointer, right? And, you know, whatever, I'll run, and you get this IOB as the output. Okay, so we're just tracking. And so now once you do that, we can also modify the type of plus pointer, which is the pointer arithmetic operation. So it's going to take a pointer P. It's going to take an offset, but this can't be some random offset. So if I had 5 bytes, you can't just move the pointer by 25 bytes. So what I'm going to say is that if you give me a pointer p, you must give me an offset, which is a natural number that is, well, it's non-negative, and it's less than n, where n is the number of bytes remaining in that buffer. Okay, so if that buffer has 10 bytes remaining, you can only bump it up by at most 10. And what you get as output is a new pointer that has that many bytes minus the offset, right? Because you just sucked up 5 bytes, whatever the offset was. Okay? So all of these are in our prelude, right, as it were, where we just sort of assume that ghc.foreign.pointer exports functions with the signature. Okay, fantastic. Now, to prevent buffer overflows, all I have to do is define a type for valid pointers. So I'll say pointer not empty of A, simply a pointer such that pln is greater than 0, so there's space remaining. And I'm going to rig it so that peek and poke take pointer not empty. You can't give it a random pointer. You must give it a pointer that has some space remaining. Okay? And this is exactly why once you sort of specify all these types, then bang, over here what it knows is that the size of P is equal to the size of FP. The size of FP is equal to 4, and I'm bumping it up by 5. Not nice. Okay, you get this peak tense. Pretty easy, right? Okay, fantastic. Next, let's look at the bytestring API. Okay, so we're going to use this very low-level pointer to build a higher-level structure, which is the bytestring. So this is what a bytestring looks like. Okay, so for those of you who have not had the pleasure of staring at the bytestring code, here's what happens. It's actually very clean. So I'm laying it out in memory. So a bytestring has three things inside it, right? So it's essentially it's a block of memory that starts at a given pointer. I'm going to call it B pointer. It's just a foreign pointer to a bunch of word aids. There's an offset that tells you where the bytestring begins. And this makes it very easy to compute suffixes of bytestring. You want to drop the first 5 characters, just bump up the pointer by 5. You drop another 4, bump it up by 4, right? So it makes it really, really fast. So there's some offset parameter that tells you where the bytestring actually begins. And then there's a length parameter that tells you how many more bytes are there, starting at that offset, right? So in this picture, the valid part of the bytestring is this green thing over here. And the red stuff is do not touch this. And in fact, even the white stuff is not part of the bytestring. Okay, so it's only the green bit that's in the bytestring. So now this seems like it's crying out for some make illegal states unrepresentable. Because there's a whole bunch of information about what is legal and what is not. But here it is. It's quite straightforward. We can just write a refined type that says, okay, B pointer is whatever. The offset is some number, which is a natural number, and must be less than the size of the buffer. The buffer had 100 elements, the offset can't be 2500, right? The size of the offset must be between 0 and 100. And the length that's remaining must be some number such that if you take that number plus the offset, you're still within the boundaries of the buffer, right? So if you just think about that green thing over there, if you had 100 bytes, your offset is at 4, then the length can't be more than 96. Okay, so I'm not making up these invariants, this is just how it is. Okay, so far so good? Fantastic. Okay, so as before, I'm just going to create a little alias for bytestrings of size n, which is just a bytestring such that bln is equal to n, right? Okay, so here are some good bytestrings. I'm going to say malloc 5, and then I'm just going to create one of these bytestrings which with the foreign pointer fp starting at offset 0 with 5 characters. That's the first one. And I can say, yes, this bytestring has size 5. The second one, I can say it has size 3. Wait, that's totally not right. This is no good. Oh, no, it is. It is. It does, in fact, have size 3, right? You see why, right? Because this size is, in fact, 3. If I was to change this to 30, for example, that would not be so good. I can't claim that this bytestring has size 30 because I only allocated 5 bytes. So I can't now suddenly magically pretend that the bytestring has 30 characters. Okay, so far so good, right? So here's a quick exercise. Can someone tell me how we would fix this? So here are 2 bad bytestrings. So I want to pretend that this bytestring has 10 characters, but LiquidHaskell says, no, it does not. What's the problem here? I just allocated 3, right? So that's obviously shady. I want to make that 10. And what's wrong with this? Why is it that this bytestring does not have size 2? I allocated 3. Exactly, but the offset's 2. So once I'm at offset 2, there's not that much space left, so I need to tweak this, and I want to make this 0. Right? Okay, fantastic. So grind, grind, grind. It'll come back, and life is good. Now, of course, this is not how one really creates bytestrings. One does not call malloc and then do it in the shady style. The real way that bytestrings are built is something like this. And this is, in fact, how it's built in the library. Right? There's a little function called create. It looks roughly like this. Create takes as input an integer. It takes a function from pointers to that return an IO action that essentially fills up that particular pointer, and then returns a bytestring. And here's how it works. Unsafe perform IO. I guess you never thought you'd see a talk with dependent types and unsafe perform IO all at the same time. But here you are, okay? This is a real world, people. Okay, create and fill unsafe perform IO, that's why we get this nice pure interface, do, you create the bystring with, you create the foreign pointer with FP, you call malloc of M, N, and then with foreign pointer FP, you call this fill function, and then you return the foreign pointer starting at offset 0 with size N. So what's the problem here? It doesn't like the N, why? Well, let's stare at the error message, it's pretty obvious. What does it say? Value is N, not a subtype of greater than 0. Remember how we said malloc must not be called with negative numbers? So how shall we tweak it? We just want to turn this int into a nat. Pretty straightforward, right? Well, we will come back to this in just a second. Come on, bytestring. There we go. Okay, so we thought we had fixed that particular problem, but not quite. Because here is another function that calls create inside the bytestring, right? So it's a function called pack. And what pack does is it takes a string, like, you know, the string, a list of characters, the old-fashioned Haskell style list of characters, and returns a bystring whose length is exactly equal to that of S. So if I give you the string burrito, then you want to get back a bystring burrito, okay, which has exactly that many characters. And now there's just like a sea of redness over here. It's like, I don't like this at all. And what do I not like? Well, first of all, I don't know if this poke is legit. I don't know how much space there is inside that pointer P. You're trying to write something there, but is there stuff there? I have no idea. Am I allowed to increment that pointer by one? And I'm calling create n. How on earth am I to guarantee that the bytestring has the same length as s? Right. So remember the type that we had for create was a rather not a terribly exciting type. Right. The type we had for create just says you give it a nat, you get back a bytestring. So can somebody tell me how would we tweak the type of create? There's a lot more that's happening inside create. There's a lot more invariants. Yes. Fantastic. So that is fact one. So what I want to say is that n is a nat, and this is a bystring n of size n. But there's more. As they say, wait, there's more. You see how you have this create function, and I'm passing into it an action, right? And all this stuff where I'm actually filling in the contents, that depends pretty crucially on what's going on with that pointer p. Right? So the reason this is not working out is that I have no idea how big that pointer is. Like, what is the size of that pointer? And so how shall I... Can you think of a way I might capture that information also in the type of create? Exactly. Okay. So in fact, it is a pointer n. It's not any random pointer. But I promise you, it will be the same pointer that you created with the nat. And hence, it will be a pointer with n bytes in it. Okay. And now, when I tweak the type of create down there, both of these will work out. Right? Or so I hope. Blah, blah, blah. Okay, fantastic. So pinkness has disappeared from here, and it has also disappeared from here. Okay, so it's a more precise type. And it's one of these cases where sometimes you have to iterate a little bit just to figure out what exactly is the right information that you need. Okay, so there we go for pack. How about this? This one's a really easy one. Here's the unsafe take function. Remember what this does is I give you a byte string, and I give you, just give me the first 5 bytes of this. But it doesn't like it. I give it an N, I give it a byte string, and here's why byte string is so fast, right? You want to take the first 5 characters? I just replace L with N. Right? You want to drop off the first 5, you want to leave, you know, a bunch of characters, you just like change the length parameter. That's it. Super fast, right? No crazy recursion, none of that stuff. But nevertheless, Liquid Haskell is not happy with our function. What's the problem? L needs to be. Yes, exactly. I can't take 5 characters if there's only 2 characters in the byte string. Right? There's some relationship between the number of things I want to take and the actual byte string size. And so what I want to say is that this nat n is in fact smaller than the size of the byte string. So I would do that by saying it's a byte string such that bln of v is greater than n is less than or equal to the bln of v. Okay. So now, because again, here we are creating one of those illegal byte strings. Not so good. And so now it's quite happy. It's like, okay, that's good, as long as you promise to call unsafe take. Okay, and here's a more involved. The unpack function is kind of like pack, except that there's a lot more stuff going on. But the high-level bit is it takes as input a byte string and returns a list of characters whose length is exactly equal to the byte string. And there's a whole bunch of stuff that's happening over here that the SMT solver is just kind of chews through, right? It all works out quite nicely. No proofs needed. Okay, so that's pretty much it. That was our second level, the bytestring API. And I promise I will finish in 60 seconds. Okay, so here is the application API. This was that same chop function at the very beginning that I was so paranoid about. Well, here's the deal. Now you see, there's this B and it's marked off in pink. It's like, no, you can't just call unsafe takeover there. That's no good. So how can we tweak this? What was the problem? Remember, you can't create a bytestring with 10 characters and then take 25 characters from it, because that's where you're reading into the overflow buffer. So how shall we fix this? How big can N be? Or S, for that matter? No bigger than the size of the list, right? So it's a NAT that is less than or equal to the length of S. And there we go. Well, not just yet, but you get the idea. Okay? And so now if I try and do this shady thing where I create, say, lambda, I can suck out 6 characters, that's fine. But if I try and pull out 30 characters, that's a type error. Right? So just reject it at compile time. Okay, fantastic. So that's pretty much it. This was just a super fast overview of how you would actually use something like this for, you know, a complicated library. You just slice it into a bunch of layers. And really, the only thing we're trusting over here is the lowest level pointer API. Right? So our memory safety policy or property is encoded inside those types. And we're kind of trusting that that's OK. But everything after that is being checked by LiquidHaskell. OK, I said I would finish, and I will finish as soon as I can just pop back right here. This is, sorry. Here we go. Okay, so we're done with the case studies. And see, I said conclusion. Here we go. Refinement types. What are refinement types? You just take, you take your types and you dress them up with predicates. You get your proofs done automatically by the SMT solver, which is fantastic. There's a whole bunch of machinery on how these types get inferred that I have completely not talked about, but that's okay. You don't really need to know about it. And the upshot is you get super automated dependent typing that you can do a bunch of things with. There's a bunch of work we're still doing. If you're interested, come and talk to me. I guess the main thing that I would really like to do is, as somebody put it, have GHC have a minus X refinement types option. That seems like a fun thing to do. So what I'd really like to do is to somehow figure out how me and Richard can somehow put our technologies together, because that'd be pretty sweet. And blah, blah, blah. There is, if you like this material, there is a ton more of it. There's a whole book that I wrote that has sort of far more involved and interesting examples. It's at this particular URL. And with that, I must stop. Thank you.